good afternoon to all of you. Last lecture we had on the concepts which we try to integrate with the dimension of leadership. We try to look at Rita, Vina and Purushartha, and I'm sure that these concepts will never be discussed with the help of case studies. Dimensions of these have been well received by almost everybody here. But there was also a request for one more lecture. So that's the reason I'm here. Because I thought that I covered every dimension of it, which I did. But you wanted something still further. And I'm grateful to everybody. Because then I also started thinking, what else, in what way I can reflect on the dimension. And so the format of my lecture today will be very simple and easy, because today we are going to just not get into any cases for you to analyze. Perhaps I will take up some cases or we will discuss it together. But prior to that, what I intend to do is to also focus not on the concepts again, but what I thought was the skills which are required, or which in a very natural flow manifest out of these concepts. Because when we talk about skills, then we also talk about nurturing those skills. And then it becomes a journey from that which is abstract to that which is more specific. And then if we have located some skills which are in this particular format, I have located three skills. We can actually infer as many. But what I thought, I have tried to focus on those three skills. So, for example, I'm just looking at implementation of a skills training program, which is based on the concept of Rita, Rina and Purushartha. So in that sense, I have tried to quantify it also. I have tried to make that abstract, which I theorized last time, but also tried to look at the praxis aspect of it. Today I am going to go a little further, assuming that all of you have kind of understood what I tried to say. So there is a possibility that there are going to be some things which I am going to repeat, but with a different framework, so that this particular understanding becomes clear. Last time I was asked a very interesting question, and I was asked this question in the sense I was given a suggestion that we must take a lecture on this. And what was that this? Someone of you said that these concepts are very interesting. These concepts are very important and they help us to understand. But how does one travel inside? What is that traveling inside? How do you make the right decision? I mean to say, in what way does this enhance you to be a good decision maker, a good leader? What is its interconnect in our day-to-day life? Or how will it help us to become a better leader? So, this was a question which was asked to me last time. And I'm grateful to the person who asked this question, because this is not a question which can be answered in a very precise way, that this is the method. I'm sure you know that. There is a lot of subjectivity in focusing on what is the, how is it going to be, what will be the process. But nevertheless, we are going to try. We are going to look at those skills which will enable us to be more effective, more aware as leaders. So this is how it will be. So as I said, that I don't promise to give you complete answer, but definitely I want to give you some framework of how this leader will emerge and in what framework these concepts will enable. Because when you talk about these concepts, I am now going to do some inferential, you know, I'm arriving at something with the help of this. So it's like a ladder. These concepts have taken me to some point, and from that I'm still going higher. So when you enter the field as leaders, you will perhaps take it to still different level. Because as I said, every leader is a different person. Every group will be a different. There will be different dynamics. So there is going to be something different and there's going to be something common. So we are going to look at the common different and the most important, we in that position to handle that different and common. So that's why life is so interesting. Because as leaders, it is an exciting journey and it is not an easy journey always. It is tough. It is a meaningful one. Sometimes there are moments where you are going to feel dejected, depressed, hopeless. You think of quitting also. But there are some occasions where you really feel, yes, this is what I like doing. This is what I have tried doing. This is how I have tried to reach out. Now this reaching out, this feeling nice, this feeling of feeling good after doing something, not just because you're getting a pay packet. When you walk an extra mile, these concepts meet you there. Rather, I would say, these concepts direct you to walk that extra mile. I'm trying to be a little poetic.
Yes.
But I'm sure everybody who is sitting here is understanding the realm of what is a leader. The leadership program teaches you to be a leader, but exactly does not tell how to go about it when you are in that mode. And that is how I look at it as a science and art. So, we all have different gadgets within to gauge people. We have, as Aurobindo says, there are the inner instruments which help us to understand ourselves and others. It's like a camera. Even if I give 20 cameras here to 20 people and tell you to capture one particular spot, you all are going to capture it in different ways. And you will have your justification why you captured the way you captured. So two success stories of leaders also are not going to be exactly the same. Or you can't copy paste it and follow it. You can take it as a guideline. Right? So this is a brief introduction to what I'm going to say. This was not a prepared one. Prepared one is here. But this was something, as I said, that when I am amidst future leaders, there is something I have received from all of you, perhaps to speak whatever I have tried to speak. And this was something spontaneously which has come, which perhaps is in connection to what I am going to speak just now. Right? So what we are going to do is first again revisit the concepts. But while revisiting, I am not going to say the same thing. I am going to look at it in a slightly different way. And what we are going to do, for example, if you are doing Ritha, we will look at Ritha as a concept. I will also try to look at Ritha from the skills point of view. What are the skills it tries? How do we arrive at those skills? And the third is when we look at situations. Well, you can only tell what are the situations where this can be used. Or we can take one example and suggest that yes, this can be done here. So, because I look at leader, a leader is not forever. Because we are like travelers, we will come and go. But the leader creates a team. And in that team, he also develops future leaders. And that's why skills become more important. Because when you train, when you yourself get trained, and then you try to pass this further, then I think in that true sense, we respect culture. We try to develop or give back to the society whatever we have tried to do. So I just feel that skills development programs, especially in context to development of leadership, based on the Indian realm or based on culture, philosophy, are the most required today. Because talking about culture, culture is not something empty. Culture is not there. Culture is something which is integrated. And this integration becomes more effective when we try to look at the, in a very simple way I could say, what you deliver, your everyday. When you go to your office as a leader, when you come back, how are you as a person? Are you the same person? Are you a happier person? Are you sad? Are you doubtful? Are you joyous? How are you? Are you getting ready for the next day? Have you carried the baggage with you? Have you forgiven some people? Have you given the other person a chance? You had all the possibilities when you were a leader. What did you do in that day? We all have a choice to live a good life or not so good life. To make our life happy, joyous, or to make it sad and depressed. We all have a choice. And the minute we try to be happy, or if we are happy from within, we try to spread this happiness. Imagine if you are a CEO of a company and you are handling some 20,000 people, your message is reaching across. That's why in last lecture I mentioned that leaders live in glass houses. Just because they live in glass houses doesn't mean they have to be good because somebody is observing you. They have to be good just for itself. Like parents, they are good always. They aren't good because there will be a rating. Nobody rates them. There are no appraisals for parents. We have appraisals in offices. It's something formal process. But can we get away with the appraisals? Can we go beyond formal appraisals? Can we just go in a different realm where we are able to make people understand why they come to the office? Can we make people understand why they have to explore their potentialities? Can we help people to understand why are they not looking at themselves in the proper way and how they should? Can we convert organizations, institutions of learning? Can we become, in the seat of manager, also a teacher, also a friend, also a philosopher, also a parent sometime? We do that, don't we? We change our roles. We shift as per the situation. And we ought to. Do we sometimes think from the other person's perspective? Like a parent may do? Are we rigid sometimes like a child? Whatever I am trying to say just now, my students, I am sure you are also imagining yourself in your own offices with your own leadership experiences and the people you have met, the situations which you have resolved, the situations which you resolved very, very nicely, the situations which were not resolved in the proper way. Those situations which made you angry, those situations which made you sad. I'm sure you have those memories. Because we always understand something with the context. This context where we are trying to look at the context of the cosmic order. When we look at the context of the cosmic order, when we talk about Ritha, this cosmic order is something which I can see. And this order is haywire also I can experience. And then I am free to say this is because they are doing like this. But in they, I am also there. So when this order becomes disorder, then the problem starts. when we get regular rainfalls, nobody discusses and nobody sits to discuss and say, how come we have had good rainfall this year? But when the rainfall is not good, when there is a global warming, that upsets us. It's human tendency that we only start thinking about the problem when it bothers us. We don't assume a problem in the first place. We wait for the problem to trouble us a little. And then we start. Now when we look at the cosmic order, especially when we look at it from the environment point of view, I think it's too late already. It's too late because it's not that we are just supposed to think, we are supposed to act. And we aren't just supposed to act, we are supposed to act in a more sensible way. So I hope that is clear. So when we are talking about cosmic order, we are not just talking about the order outside only. Definitely the order outside has to be maintained. And when will you maintain it? For example, I always give this example to my students. If I tell you, this is the last chalk piece on planet Earth, and I give it to him, how will his attitude be towards the chalk?
Preserve
it. He'll take a lot of care because this is the last. Right? There is no second for this. So, plus, for him it is a useful thing. He understands that without which it will not be possible to write anything on the board. Today we have other options, but I am just saying if you only had one option. So, when we talk about the cosmic order is not just about cosmic order, but the order is trying to enhance one's life, integrate one's goal. It also helps us to elevate. Are you understanding? And that's the reason why we are trying to say this. There is a cosmic order which is outside, but there is also an order inside. So there is some kind of a rhythm with the outside and the inside. If you see the Rutu chakras, the Rutu chakras, when we look at the patterns of different climatic seasons, that affects our, we start feeling cold or we start feeling heat. We feel like eating something garam garam and all that. There is something which is a reflection from the outside which has an inside. So you suddenly start searching for your sweaters and all that. So there is some kind of a communication which is happening of the outside with the inside. Isn't it? Or when we, a simple thing last time I mentioned, having food at a particular time, taking rest, doing all that, there's a body clock. If you don't follow the body clock, what happens? Like for example, you have your lunch at 5 o'clock in the evening, you sleep at 3 a.m. and wake up at after say 12 hours, every day you sleep for 12 hours. You someday have food, someday you don't have food. What happens finally to the body?
Physical system goes topsy-turvy.
Yeah, it goes topsy-turvy. It gives you signals also. Or sometimes when we don't go by the patterns outside, it is extremely cold outside and we consume cold, what happens? And some people say, no, nothing will happen to me, I am very strong. Sometimes you challenge the body also. Like, the char ice cream bhi kha sakte. So this is where we are trying to say that there is arrogance also in assuming. We don't follow the order. I can do anything to nature. Somebody says, if I cut a tree, what will happen? If I cut ek chhad se, kya hoga? But if 50,000 people say that in 1 minute in different parts of the world and do it, you can understand the damage which is done, because this is faulty thinking which is going against the order. I'm just giving you one example. This order is in connect to nature, in connect to human and animal life and insect life and everybody, and there is a respect, there is a connect, there is a harmony, there is something which is complementary, there is a dependence, there is a coexistence, isn't it? If I only think about myself, for example, you are cleaning your car, washing your car, and you put a pipe, and with the pipe you are cleaning your car, and your neighbor says, why are you wasting water? You say, what's your problem? It's my tap, it's my water, so I'm cleaning my car. You must have come across people who say all this.
Many times.
If I am honking the horn, what is your problem? So these are me-centric people. Me-centric. They are not me-centric. They do not think they owe anything to this civilization, to this planet, Earth. They only think they have something only when there is a benefit. Otherwise, they don't think.
Benefit to them.
Benefit to them. Self-centered. Now, when we talk about cosmic order, if everybody becomes selfish, can we maintain the order? Cannot. Or if I become so selfish that sometimes even my body also is a victim of my own selfishness, because I like sweets, I eat sweets. I like it. But my system may not like it. But am I listening to my system who's bothered? Nobody is bothered, because I'm so impulsive that I like sweet. And somebody says, sir, you will fall ill. Doesn't matter, when I fall ill, I will take medicines. Means I am not even bothered the kind of exploitation I am doing to the body. If one is so careless about one's own body, do you think that person who think about the cosmic order, about coexistence, about the process of understanding, helping the other, you can't even help yourself. You can't even maintain an order for your own self. Cosmic order is something still beyond. Some people mock at people who are very disciplined. If they do exercise, eat in time, they mock at such people. Why? Because it is very easy to mock at someone. If somebody is doing Surya Namaskar, if somebody is taking breakfast in time, if somebody is studying in time, giving time to music, and giving all that time which is required for the body and the soul. Excellent. But when we can't do it, we like to laugh on it. So the body mind also has a rhythm. There is also order. Body mind has an order, and that's why you look at outside, where I think that beyond myself is something which I have to reach out to people. It's only when I harmonize that I think about the harmony outside. If I am only agitated, if I am only sick, if I am only diseased, will I have that potentiality to take care of anything outside me? Never. I hope you are understanding what I am trying to say. It's a little abstract, but I don't think it's that abstract. Because these were the things which I did not touch upon last time. And I'm doing this with a purpose today, because I'm going to arrive at a skill. I've done some experiment. I've done some kind of out-of-the-box thinking. And I've entered into a skill area where skills are generally perceived as something which are specific. These are specific, but the dimension of these skills can be taken beyond the specificities of a skill. Right. So, you are eager to know what are the skills which we arrive at after knowing about Ritha. What perhaps are those skills? And in office situations for a leader, in what way these will be useful? Okay. And we can also debate whether these are really meaningful or meaningless. Madam, you made a mistake. It's possible. So I'll now tell you which are the skills which I think I've arrived at when I tried to study this particular thing, and which we have to cultivate, nurture, if we want to become effective leaders. First skill which I have is the skill of self-awareness. Now I'm talking about Ritha, then I will talk about Rina, then I will talk about Purushartha, and we can also see whether we could swipe these skills or some skills may overlap. That's a possibility. But the point is to understand in what way these skills are. That's why when I started thinking in a separate way, I said this will be better because I will come up with some more skills. Otherwise, every skill can be applicable. So first is the skill of self-awareness. I'll first state, then I'll explain. Second is cooperation. In bracket, you can also write coexistence in case you're writing. Third is humility. There can be 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. There can be n number. Now we will go to the skills. The first skill. In context to the dimension which we studied, that is Ritha. And in this context we are trying to say that when we talk about Ritha, when we talk about the skill, Ritha is something which cannot be converted into a skill. Please don't misunderstand. Ritha and its dimensions are vast. But for the leadership dimension, we can also evolve a skill out of whatever the treasure of knowledge in context to Ritha is. And in that context is self-awareness. Is that clear?
So self-awareness is a skill.
Yes.
If we are looking in context to Ritha.
So, when we talk about self-awareness, I will try to reflect on that also. That when we are trying to reflect on self-awareness and cooperation and humility, in what context is it trying to come? I will try to suggest. Yeah?
Why Ritha cannot be converted into a skill? Let's say cosmic order. Like the sun rising, sun setting, and adjusting our activities to that cosmic order. Just take example, sunrise, sunset. Cannot that be a skill?
No, but what I am trying to say, we are not going to reduce Ritha only to this. Ritha is something vast, that's what I am trying.
This is a thing.
So out of that, we are coming to some skills. As I said, I have done an experiment and we are going to see how this experiment unfolds. And we are also going to see in that context because it is a little abstract. But it is not so abstract when we look at it from the skill point of view. For example, when I am trying to say about self-awareness. So when we talk about the dimension of self-awareness, you become aware of your own self. Now when you become aware of your own self, there is a context of that order. There is a balance. There is a balance. When I become aware of myself, what do I exactly mean by that? When I am becoming self-aware, when we talk about the patterns of awareness, I am aware that there is a chalk, I am aware that there is a duster. This awareness is outside. I am aware of so many things on the table, plus I'm aware that there are students in front of me. There is awareness. But when I talk about self-awareness, this awareness tries to focus that there is something within. There is something which is within, which needs to be nurtured, which needs to be cultivated, which needs to be understood, which needs to be explored. So when I start exploring this, I am trying to make this connect of the outside and the inside more focused. Our topic talks about the external and the internal, outer and the inner. So here we are trying to say that there is a self-awareness, where we are trying to say that this awareness, where I have become aware, I become so focused that I become aware. And when I become aware, that means I become more sensitive to the realm of that self which is in me. So I also start getting direction from the self. It's not that always you start asking others about your questions. Many a times the direction is inside. It's not always that when you are in a group, only you feel the joy. Sometimes you need that solitude. It's not always that in the midst of employees around you that you find solutions. It is in that moment when you are with yourself that an excellent idea comes to you. It's in that pattern of self-awareness that you also go back to your own self and find out the people you have hurt, the decisions which you took very aggressively, the moments when you were selfish. In some ways, those things which you did where you did not maintain the order. Am I clear with it? So, when I am thinking about self-awareness, when I am trying to reflect upon self-awareness, I am trying to say that I start going beyond my selfish pursuit. So I also have a dimension about that order, that cosmic order. I have that awareness about that self-awareness gives me a direction to maintain that cosmic order. Because I now become more focused. Now I become more understanding. Now I become more matured. So I don't just live for myself, but I live for others also. So I think about people in my office who may be younger than me, who may be very dynamic. I have to shape them to take care of the future of my, not only my company, but of my country, of the world. For example, if we have a plan of Factory A, Factory A will give you crores of rupees of profit. But while making the plan of profit, which you will get, Factory A is positioned in such a way that the fumes which will come out of the factory are going to kill 50,000 trees which are around the factory. Are you understanding? Mm-hmm. I'm going to use these objects, that's why I'm sitting and explaining to you that if you imagine that this is a pattern. Now if this is the factory and if these are the farms, these are the trees. This factory promises me to give profit. So I am a leader of today. I live for today. If I am a leader of today, then there is a possibility that I will not think about maintaining the order. It's going to be, I get pleasure out of it, so why should I bother? the trees are dying, if water is polluted, if people are getting affected, getting diseased, those who are staying in these huts, no, that's not my problem. I'm just trying to look at this cosmic order which is trying to get affected because I have become so self-centered that I'm not looking at the animal world, I'm not looking at the plant world, I'm not looking at those people who really don't matter to me, but they matter to me. So that interconnect. I just gave a very simple and a very ordinary example. So when you are making your leadership plans, when you are trying to focus on a particular plan, or when you are a leader who should have a future goal. You can be a unique leader. Others will laugh at you and say, oh, what are you doing? You will not get profit anytime if you start thinking about all this. And then what do you say? If I get less profit, that is fine. But if I am giving something sensible to the planet on which I stay, I think I am on the right path. So what is that giving back to that planet I am trying to do? Am I giving back anything? So this self-awareness stops the greed. This self-awareness makes me less frivolous. Or perhaps it tries to help me to go beyond all that which is frivolous. So I don't now work for profit, I work for prosperity. I work for harmony. Profit as such I will get. But this is wealth. This is wealth in a very intangible pattern. This is wealth of taking effort of protecting what we have conserved for so many years. Just imagine if trees were talking to the machines in the industry, what would their talk be?
I'm suffocating.
Can a leader sometimes when looks out of the window, imagine what this conversation is? What is the conversation between the trees and the machines in my factory? Because when I am not there, they are there. The machines are in the room and the trees are in the background, peeping from some window. What may be their discussion about the leader? The machines may say, our leader gives us a lot of attention. And some of my more family members are going to join soon. And the tree has a sad story to say. The tree says, your leader is going to put us off. And we heard the other day when the discussion was happening over the phone. Machine say, what can we do? You have to go away. Because you are of no use. You don't produce like we do at the mass level. And the tree said, we do produce. But you can't see. We also take care of the nature. We also take care of the atmosphere. But who will bother? Just looking at it in a very philosophical way. That if such a dialogue is happening between the tree and the machine, what will be this dialogue? And as a leader, you suddenly enter your office and you listen to this dialogue. And then what will be your state? And whose side? You will say, oh tree, I agree with you. I completely agree with you. But you must understand my position because I am here to make profit. Are you understanding what I am trying to say? So it's like, there are some companies who have tree plantation program. And they have tree plantation program at the same place, at the same time every year. You are a leader, you have a say. You can change the wheel. You don't have to work as and think the way people are thinking. Are you understanding what I'm trying to say? So this conversation which we are trying to say between the machine and the tree. So the tree always will give us some kind of a dimension of that cosmic order. Because the tree says, my dear machine, I just don't talk with you, I also talk with the sky, I also talk with the birds. I also talk with the animals who come in the evening back home. I also talk to the sun and the moon. And I also talk to the stars. I also talk to the wind. I also talk to the raindrops. To whom do you talk? I only talk to the laborers who have so many problems, who are also afraid of me, because some of my own cousins will come, they will be out of their job. So when we look at this cosmic order, this is a very interesting order, very fascinating. And that's why as leaders, when we are trying to move in our own way we are going out, are we listening to these dimensions? That is being self-aware. Because in them is me and in me it is them. When we talk about the Pancha Mahabhutas, I may be a multi-millionaire, I may have all the wealth, but if I don't have clean air to breathe, what is the use? If I don't have clean water to drink, what is the use? If I don't have clean food, if I'm eating a food also there is contamination, what is the use? If I can't sleep well because I'm worried about my wealth, what is the use? Are you understanding what I'm trying to say? I tried again to be a little poetic when I talked about the machine and the tree. But I really feel all of you as leaders should think about such conversations when you look out of your window, wherever you're sitting in your office. But our offices today are so closed in the literal sense also. We have air conditioners. We don't allow ourselves to look outside. And we don't even look within. So where are we looking then?
WhatsApp. Computer screen. Mobile screen. WhatsApp.
So I hope this is clear. So first is self-awareness, skill. See how I try to look at it. So if I am trying to be self-aware, I will. Self-awareness is not a one day, fine day, you become self-aware. Like on Thursday at 3:30, I will be self-aware. It's not like that. It's something with which you grow. It's something by which you start peeping. It's through that you start exploring and then you become aware. As I become aware, for example, when I entered, I did not become aware of the table. Only when I saw this, I became aware, oh, this is a table, there are so many things on that. Similarly, when I close my eyes, when I sit in silence, and I sit in silence for 10 minutes long and I'm focused, and when I open my eyes, I may find that I am a very calm person. A leader is very angry with somebody because there is arrogance. I am a leader. So you can throw your weight around. Nobody is going to question you because you are supposed to do that. A leader is supposed to. When people also say leader and Ram, so aisa hi rahe. Why can't we change these definitions which are unwritten but accepted everywhere casually? So if a leader is self-aware, he will understand that as I am a human being and if somebody says something to me, I feel bad. If I say something to the other also will feel bad. Now your question will be, should we not tell people when they are wrong? Definitely you should say. But the way you say should be in a subtle way. That is the technique of a leader. You should say also, but you should not hurt also. Itna time kisko hai? Fire. That requires wisdom. Because you are a part of that organization, it is like a family, there is a coexistence, there is an order in the family also, no? If you hurt someone today, do you think people will be happy tomorrow looking at you? What will be their internal communication happening? Kal jane ka hi not. I don't want to see that person. The leader may be right, but you try to cross your boundaries. Instead of telling the person how the person was wrong, it can be done in a half a minute's time, you took 1 hour to reach that half a minute. So what did you do? You tried to throw your weight, you could not control, you could not balance, and you became arrogant and you ceased to be a good leader. And some people say, yeah, I'm bad leader, maybe I'm bad, I can't control, I can't. Then you better learn. Because you are sitting in a position where you have to nurture it. Are you understanding what I'm trying to say?
Now, what if you are at the receiving end of the leader? Here we are talking about that as a leader, how you are feeling. But
yes.
Let's say you are at the receiving end and you know that you are right and your leader is wrong and he is throwing the weight on you.
So you can, that's what we are trying to say. If you know you are right and the leader is wrong, then what do you do? If you are faith, if you are a moral courage, in a very, very, with the use of wisdom, you can tell your leader you are wrong. You can say it in such a way that you don't offend the person. For example, you are in a meeting and you don't agree with the perspective which the leader has given and you know that it will not help the company. So you can always say, I am thinking from a different perspective, maybe I am right or wrong, you stated in the first place. And I appreciate what you say, but there's a way to say it. Not say, no, I think you're wrong. Absolutely wrong. What I say is right, then over. Then you have already heard the person who thinks he is always right. So the same thing, you can say it in a different way.
A different time.
With a different tone.
Also, I think
with a very honest this. You also don't, you should not have any vitiated interest. Dekha. What you could not think, I have thought. If that feeling is there, the leader will sense it. Why leader all others will also sense it? And your possibility of becoming a good leader will be not somebody, you are yourself trying to go away from that leadership. Because people are watching you also. Try to disrupt the cosmic order or any order, nobody likes that. In a company, if the leader is corrupt, maybe 4 or 5 people will say, kuch nahi hota hai, what is wrong? But there are 25 people who are against that disorder. There are 25 communication patterns which are happening in your presence and absence. Is a cosmic order. Whosoever is doing wrong will be punished. If not today, but tomorrow. It will not be just ignored. And I always feel people say, oh, if there are corrupt people, they are not punished only. And I tell, being corrupt itself is a punishment. itself, that is the first defeat. That you felt like doing a wrong action. What else can that be? It's what else? You are into that pattern of thought that you don't know that that wealth is not really going to help you. You are a murkha. You know you are not going to take anything. So why are you just trying to do all that where it will give you a bad name, bad health? Murkha.
So many.
Yeah, so many. They're murkha.
It's a...
Because they don't have foresight, they don't have that wisdom.
They don't have the contentment.
They don't have contentment, they don't have the wisdom to understand that there is something like contentment.
Dharma doesn't allow that. Dharma down the...
They don't have that foresight, no. They will justify with money, I will buy this, I will buy that. But after that what? With money can you buy honesty? With money can you buy dignity? With money can you buy good health? Nothing. And so, what will this person be murkha?
How do we change them?
Self-awareness.
We cannot change them, we can help them to change themselves. You cannot change anybody in this world.
We can change only ourselves.
By making them self-aware. But it's also about us, no? If we change, and if our ways, we are more honest like you said, and we are genuine, that is possible. They say, okay, we take one question at a time because then I am going away from my discussion and I think we can keep our questions later so that what I want to complete, I will complete, otherwise I can just go. Your questions are very, very interesting. Kindly write it in your books. Ask me when we have the question hour. I know you may say, oh, I wanted to ask the question now only. I am going to tell you later.
So Jitin, you have to say, I appreciate what you are saying.
Yeah.
This is what I want to tell you.
Exactly.
Wisdom of being a leader.
So I am sure what I wanted to say, I have tried to say. So we are still in the first skill. No? We still
yes.
have to do the other.
Yes.
I am sure you are enjoying this discussion.
Yes.
Yes.
So, self-awareness is something still deeper and whatever we have discussed, we can't completely discuss that this is it. Self-awareness has different patterns and if you ask me, how can we develop self-awareness? If I am in an office, if I want to be a self-aware leader, how should I develop self-awareness? So there are certain things which are aware about through yoga, you can do that. Second thing, so with yoga there are lot of things which you can do. This communication channels open, you start looking within, your approach changes, you start moving from the gross to the refined, right? And when all this happens, your eating patterns change, your sleeping patterns change, your approach changes, so you start slowly start tuning to become self-aware. I still want to say that everybody who does yoga does not get into self-awareness mode right away. Some people are only busy saying, I do yoga. I do yoga. When you keep saying that means you are not doing it. Because still there is an urge to tell it. It's the same like I am a very spiritual person. Why do I have to tell it? If you are spiritual, it should manifest. So can we stop talking about our own self and let people come at particular decision about you? Can we start talking about development of other people than praise of my own self? Can we just switch off that me my talk for some time?
Sorry, I didn't touch. Exactly, I think that's a funny so someone commented that like, this is my book and my this and you're like why me my so in the lens of that's why when you say this
this is we all have this me my talk sometime or the other today X may have tomorrow Y may have
yeah
negative may have because we as human beings have the me my
yeah
But as leaders, we should have that we, not me.
We-centric,
so that concern is there. You can't say, I'm like that only, I'm short-tempered only, I like to punish people. Well, you like, but that is not the way you say it. Or not to make the other person feel very helpless in your company. Sometimes some leaders like to show that. Oh, you don't know this also, and you don't know that also, and that person said, my God, this person is everything.
We come across so many people like this.
So, a good leader, does it interest you what I'm saying? Or
it is.
Whatever I'm saying just now. I said a very important point. The point is, as a leader, you may have your own skills, you may have your own potentialities, but do you make the other person who's not a leader, you are guiding that person, do you make the person feel very comfortable? Mm-hmm. Or do you make him feel very awkward? Do you start making him feel that he is there? Do you start throwing your weight whenever it is possible? And talking only about it, yourself. Oh, when I was of your age, I used to do this in so many, you know, I was very efficient. Not like you. That negative talking to the other reflects on your ego, which is getting all that pleasure of doing that. The minute you are self-aware, gradually, you will not talk about yourself in that sense. There will be a different kind of exploration. When you start becoming self-aware, when you start going to the balance and the cosmic order, maybe you also start becoming more innovative. My company produces this, but because of this, there is so much of pollution. Can I think about anything else which will not give rise to pollution? Can I think about a machine which I can develop which will... Now this comes out of self-awareness. This is something positive. This is something which is helping you to elevate, which is taking care of that order also, and your business is also going fine. It's difficult because you have to think out of the box. It may also be like there is a possibility that you may get loss also when you launch such products. But you're ready for it. Are you understanding what I'm trying to say? So 24/7 we are with our own self. Now also lecture is going on. Ask yourself whether you are with yourself, whether you are with the lecture, or whether you are with your WhatsApp. You are with your program in the evening already. Honest over ourselves. As leaders, if we are not honest over ourselves, how can we expect people to work always in the office when you are around and not around us? Are we with our own self when we are with ourselves? And then if we expect people to be always with the world, are we asking for too much? Are we trying to have two different standards, one for them and one for myself? Am I clear to this? Are you getting what I wanted to say through the skill development which I am trying to say?
Yes.
But that usually happens in organization. Huh. Leadership standards and what they expect of what people down the line.
Huh.
I can put one example. In my previous organization, there were some bungalows which the company owned. And as employees, all of us had access virtually, so we can book the bungalow and go for a weekend.
Okay.
But they were on lease and company wanted to close down the lease. This information was never released to people down the line.
Okay.
Now the directors went and entered the bungalows and then they closed the lease for them.
Okay. So, information was trying to divert the information, keeping it with only some people. Self-centered. If there was a leader who said, let my class 4 employee also go and stay in the bungalow, let him also experience that. That is wisdom. I come in a company car every day, the leader says. One day, the sweeper who cleans the office, let me send the car for him and let me give him that joy. One day, it doesn't really matter to you, but it will matter to him. Do we respect human beings as human beings?
Very less time.
And in that sense, I am self-aware that without telling, I understand the problem of the other. That's most important. A leader should not always ask his employees, oh, what are the problems? Come on, tell me. No. Like a good physician, when the good physician looks at you, if he's a very good physician, knows whether you're fit or not fit. Like a mother who looks at the son or a daughter and says, today you are not looking okay. I think you did not have your lunch or whatever. The mother knows. Like a farmer who looks at the clouds and says, it's going to rain in some 2-3 hours time. There are no gadgets for all this, my dear students. It's all from within. It's a higher level of understanding, love, affection and wisdom. This is not taught in any business schools. There's a school within which teaches us this. And if you are able to understand, a lot of learning can take place from within. That's why we have to give a lot of time for this self-engagement, for this exploration. And for that, every day at least some minutes in silence. Not phone on silent mode, is silence. You in the silent mode. And maybe for 5 minutes, then 7 minutes, then 10 minutes, but sit in that silence. Maybe you give this kind of experience to employees in your own company, your own friends. Don't keep it very secret. Oh, madam said silence. Kaam karega. Dekho jaane do. Dekho kya karega. Again that order. If you want everybody to be integrated, this has to pass on. And this is not something private, no. If the other person is calm, good for you. If you are only calm and the other person is agitated, then what is thing? He will make you more nervous. Challenges come from outside also, no? So if all the employees are trained for this calmness, what a fantastic atmosphere it will be. Will it not be?
Yes. Very positive.
So if you do such experiments in your own companies as a leader, if you can make everybody sit together, everybody, from the top to bottom in that ring of this together, that also is taking care of the problem.
The owner of Zara or Dio, he still has lunch with all his employees.
Yes. So these are rare examples, but nevertheless they are there. Do you look at the Indian philosophical dimension, when you look at the culture, it is always of that coexistence. We have always not looked down upon anything. There are different traditions which are there at the same time. There is a lot of dialogue which takes place in our country since 5,000 years. This dialogue also has to happen in our own companies as leaders and the employee. And these dialogues should be beyond the barrier of language, religion, caste, creed, culture. It should be just a dialogue with one human person to another, a dialogue with human nature. We don't want concrete jungles. So leader should have a vision. Leader should have a vision of this cosmic order. In what way I can take care of that cosmic order? Am I clear with this? Yeah? So this is something as a first dimension of it. Second is cooperation. Cooperation. Again in Rita it comes as cooperation, because when we talk about the order, coexistence and cooperation both are happening. So when we talk about Rita, this is the cosmic order. And whenever we talk about the cosmic order, there is a, we are helped. we are guided, we are taken care of. There is a coexistence. For example, when we look at the tree has a connect to the sky, the tree has a connect to the earth, to the soil.
Yes.
The tree has a connect to the atmosphere. So there is an interconnect where the tree is. Same about a human person. I have a connect to the dimensions which are around. So when you talk about Panchamahabhutas, and plus when we look at the order, when we look in a family, when we look in the society, when we look at the leaders, when we look at the order inside and outside, there is a cooperation. Our organs also cooperate with us. If they don't, then we give rise to diseases. That's why if we take good care of our organs, then we will be disease free. So order is required there, so maintenance is required there, and if we do that, then there will be cooperation and coexistence is very, very important. If I have this, that I only want to exist, then over. If human being only wants to exist and he says, I don't want a single tree because I want to become a multi-billionaire, I will have a building here also, here also, here also. Is it coexistence? Not at all. Am I clear with this? So, because in this coexistence only there is order. Imagine. If there was a human person who got so busy in the process of development that he developed roads, aeroplanes, airports, factories, and he had got so tired that one day there were only cities with gadgets and roads, and there was no human person in it. How would that city be?
No man's land.
We are getting ready for such cities. Because we are victims of psychosomatic disorders. We are stressed people. We don't know what we are doing at the end of the day. We aren't taking care of our own health. We are exploiting others. We don't even have time to talk to others. That's why WhatsApp. So where are we actually heading? What are we doing? Are we trying to get into that, where there will be nobody? We may have achieved something, but at the end of the day, we will be beggars. Because we will not have food rains, we will have tsunamis more, we will have destruction, we will have crores of people, unfortunately, God forbid, but we are going to see all this. And if we are not bothered, if we are not hurt, if we are not concerned, then get ready for such a land where no human person will. Is this giving back to the world in which we are? Is this maintaining the order?
No.
I hope I have given you the answer. What is cooperation and coexistence is. Right? And then we have one more. Our third is humility. So when we talk about humility, what is the focus? Now can someone explain to me what this humility is?
Understanding the
others.
Okay.
Humbleness
and
humbleness. Can you explain in context to rhythm? Because our entire focus is on rhythm, skill and leader. These are our three keywords, right?
Expression of gratitude towards the things that we have been receiving from others. So we should be gratitude towards others.
Okay.
We should express our gratitude.
Appreciate the other.
His nature is born out of love, so we have to give love back.
Very good. Anything else?
A tree laden with fruit always bounce.
Right.
So no matter, it is said that not just mythologically but also naturally, whatever is wise or is very bountiful is humble in a way. So that is what humility is.
Okay. Anything else?
Basically, in the Rita context, you understanding that you are just a cog in a larger wheel of cosmic order, and be grateful.
So there is a humility in that. Mm-hmm. It's like
if you look at the Milky Way, the galaxy, the universes which are beyond us, you feel you are so insignificant.
Vivekananda, in his complete works of Swami Vivekananda, gives a story, but this is in different context. I'll tell you the context later, but I'll tell you the story which has a connect. So there are two frogs. One is a frog from the well, and there is one frog from the
ocean.
So they are relatives, of course. So one day what happens, the frog from the sea or the ocean decides to visit the frog from the well. So the frog from the well welcomes. Now don't ask me how do frogs welcome, I don't know, you can imagine. So he is welcomed, and this frog from the well is a very kind frog, but has one problem. Problem is, it is never born out, and it thinks that this well is the biggest. There is nothing bigger than the well. So when this frog from the sea comes, or the ocean comes, he says, have you seen any place bigger than this? You must be so happy looking at this well. And the frog from the sea smiles. Don't even ask me how they smile. Vivekananda closes this story. He tells, adds, we all are like the frog from the well. He has used this story in context to religion. He says, we hardly know our religion, but still we say our religion is the best, and we don't know other religion, and we say the other religion is worst. And that is where I am just like the frog from the well. Very interesting and a very short story, but which gives you a glimpse of human nature, which we should not have cultivate this kind of an approach. We should eliminate this. And the minute we start eliminating, I think elevation will start. Right? So this story, please keep in mind every time when you want to talk about your own self. There is still someone higher. There is still someone wiser. There is still someone who has created. It's like, there are people who like to talk about their education, about their work experience. And they keep talking, without realizing that the person who is sitting may have still more experience, may be still wiser. And you know the sign of a wise person is?
Quiet.
Wise person is quiet, doesn't talk much. So he who knows that he knows not, and is a fool. And he who knows not that he knows, is a wise person. Great philosopher said that. I repeat, he who knows that he knows not, and is a fool. He who knows not that he knows is a wise person. I'll add to that, there are only few people who are wise, and there are many who are otherwise. So wisdom makes you understand what is the purpose, why you are in this world, and what is your duty, because our focus is on being duty-centric. If you are duty-centric, then the Ritta dimension will be taken. If we are right-centric, then we only live for that particular. We may only think, what will be my benefit, and everything will collapse in that process. So am I clear with the Ritta dimension? Can I move to Rina? I can go on with Ritta also for an hour or so, but we don't have time. So we go to Rina. As I said, these are interconnected. I'll give you 2 minutes. Tell me what is it. You can write and tell me. Write it, what is according to you, Rina. Rina.
debts incurred by the very virtue of our existence.
Okay. To give back. Okay.
Duties and obligations one needs that we have to within our
company. Okay. Since we are born, society, family, everybody contributes for our life, so we have to give back.
Okay.
There are so many things, since the time of birth, we consume things from the nature and surroundings against which we need to pay back.
We have to return with gratitude.
Okay.
Our gratitude towards all those and towards everything that has shaped our destiny.
Okay. Also, the reason of coexistence.
Anything else? Okay. So technically you all are right at full marks. Whatever you say. So I need not repeat it, but I will say something inferential. I will try to reflect on the inferential aspect of it. When we talk about Rina, these are debts. And whenever we talk about debts, we talk about obligations. We talk about the purpose why these debts. We also talk about these obligations, and we also have to think about repaying. Isn't it? A person who doesn't repay is a defaulter. So there are two categories of people. One who are not even aware that they have taken a debt. Absolutely no awareness. You must have said met people who said, I am self-made. You may be at a particular point in your life you are self-made, but the point in where you have reached and where you are saying you are self-made, there is someone who has given you that. And not one, there are so many people. So there is category one, they are not aware that there is a debt. There is a category two, who are aware but not bothered. What if my parents have taken care of me? They have to. What if my teacher is not? They have to. My parents paid fees for them. So what is so great? Nothing great. They have not done a favor. All this language starts. There is a kind of a taking these for granted. There is a category three. Yes. My parents did a lot for me. My teachers also did a lot for me. God is also helping me a lot.
Simple
thing.
That is also important. There's a fourth category. Who is aware, and is not just aware, but who gets into the mode of giving back, not just because they have given, but gets that joy in giving back. You always don't help your parents because they helped you. You do it because you feel from within to, you know, do something, and it's all camouflage in love.
But isn't this part of Rita? Because all parents will do for the children, and those children, when they become parents, they do for the children.
My dear student, all parents don't do. They may not be aware. Every parent may not. Although they are supposed to.
They don't.
We all are supposed to do so many things, but we don't do. We all are supposed to work in our offices for 8 hours, only work, but we don't do. We are supposed to take care of our country, but that we don't do. We are supposed to do many things, but we don't do. So everybody may not be that fortunate also, of getting a good parent, of getting a good teacher. it is not even assumed. It is not like everybody gets it. Some of us are fortunate to get it. All or not. You go to an orphanage, you visit an orphanage, there are so many children who did not get that love and direction. And they became juvenile delinquents or whatever. There are children who have parents but still are orphans. There are again categories. It's sad but true. There are parents so busy with their own conflicts that they don't get time to nurture a child. There are parents with so much of ego that they don't think that they have to give something to their children. And they ruin the future of the child.
They're imposing their decisions on them.
They impose, they ignore. We have seen such, you may have come across. So, I hope you got my answer.
This goes in every direction.
So, I'm trying to tell you about the fourth category. Where I'm aware also and I'm doing something, but one more important thing. We may never be able to give back to the fullest. And we can't say, "Acha, this is it, now or Matrurina or." This is eternal. Even if our parents are not around, remembering them in the time of crisis. Please listen. Very important point I'm going to tell you. We may be miles away from a place and away from our parents, but in a crisis situation, suddenly you listen to your mother's advice, your mind. Beta, aisa nahi. You don't contact her, it's not possible to contact her maybe, but you are given a direction. There may be small and big things. Where your father may have said, people will tempt you with money. But be careful with such people. We all have got such kind of tips from our own parents, our teachers. So they are not physically always with us, but they are in thought. They have inspired us to do some good actions. So that is something as a debt forever. And in that advice was care. In that advice was love. In that advice was also experience, because they have seen the world and so they give you some important insight about that world, which you cannot get in any source book or knowledge. You cannot get it on your Google, isn't it? The most difficult questions you have, and go and speak to your parents or teachers and you get answers. They have a perspective. They may not know your management language. They may not know your company. They may not know what product. But they may give very simple thoughts. But those may be, they may not be of your generation. They will never be. They still know what is this generation all about, the insight. That's why. Investing time with such people is to enrich your own life. So in that sense, I do not really feel that we will be able to fulfill. We get into it more and more. The more and more we are in contact, the more and more the focus is, the more and more dimension. I will ask you a question at the end of the lecture. I'm going to ask you a question. You know what question I'm going to ask. You know what question I'm going to ask? I will ask for
it. Ask all the questions.
I know all the questions.
The question is, whatever we talk about Rina, how is Rina connected to personality development? It's a very different question. does it have any connect to a personality? In formation of your personality? Definitely yes.
Gratitude.
So there is, if your personality is of that, where you have become aware, you have acknowledged, you will be more emotionally mature person.
Yes. You connect well.
And now I am going to ask you, what are the skills which emerge out of this? First, as we already have come here closer, is the first skill is gratitude. There is attitude of gratitude. It is the first skill which emerges out of learner. Should we train people to be have this gratitude? Yes, definitely. We should cultivate if they don't know. Gratitude for being here, the gratitude for the wonderful atmosphere, gratitude towards Mother Nature. The minute we have this gratitude, we will become more focused. This gratitude is required for the ego bending also. Attitude of gratitude is required to receive gifts with grace and to reciprocate. Not to be thankless. Even a small thing somebody has done, you have to have it. That also has a connect to your self-awareness. Are you aware that so many people have done so much? Are you aware? That a matchbox which comes to your house, so many people are involved in making that matchbox. The newspaper which you nicely read in your house, early morning somebody has walked up and given you it in time. You will have usko bill dete hum. Is there a thank you very much for that person who comes through? You never see. You only open when he's not there. Generally. The milkman, the sweeper. The person who cleans your house, the person who cleans your table, the person who says don't cross, there's a car coming fast, don't. People who have avoided so many accidents. Scientist, artist, we have gratitude, I've got good music to listen, I can just switch on and listen. Gratitude to someone who created it. Sitting under a fan, gratitude to the person who made this. I mean to say, it is an endless list. And finally, gratitude to our parents, to all those who may not be our parents but are of that age, who are around us. Blessings count. There are people who give us some kind of a direction when they just meet you. Every person teaches you something, if you are ready to learn something from that person. Even a small child may teach you something. Am I ready to learn? Do I have this attitude of gratitude? Are you understanding what I am trying to say? So if I'm open, then I have this, I don't have this arrogance, and if I don't have arrogance, I have this attitude of gratitude. Should a leader have this attitude of gratitude? Or leadership? Why should I thank them? What they will think, I am a weak person, because I am thanking them, they have to do this work. Will I be perceived as a weak leader if I start thanking people?
No.
Not at all.
You get respected.
Get respect. You will definitely get respect. And as a wise leader, you will not thank people just like that, to flatter them. There are people who just thank in a very artificial way. Thank you. But they don't mean it. So right from the watchman at the doorstep of your company, till the canteen person, everybody, find out, make a list of people you have not yet thanked. And thank them. And how do you feel and how do they feel? And what do you lose? Nothing. What do you gain? You feel nice. If in a company we have this attitude of gratitude, which comes through the dimension of Rina, a leader will be well accepted leader, a leader will be connected to the other, a leader will be more self-aware, a leader will not say maine hi sab kiya. If you, as I said, a self-made man says I only did, so that person's parents will say what you did. We taught you how to do it. There was one particular survey which was done in one country. I read it wrong back, so I don't exactly remember the facts. So parents were called in a particular organization, and employees were not told about it, that their parents are coming to the office. And their parents were taken to each table where the child, now the employee, sat. It was a surprise visit by the parents. And they wanted to rate how did the person keep the table. You know, and it was a surprise visit. So they were very surprised why parents are very elderly people, why they have come to the office. So they were taken on a tour. And then some tables were full of dust. Some were totally, and then the parents took a note. And then, is this what we taught you? It was done somewhere, but I don't remember. I read it in a newspaper or a magazine in the western country somewhere. But I'm just trying to say, if our parents were to come to our own office and watch us as leaders from some corner, how would we be?
Very conscious.
One, conscious one. Second, what would be the positive dimension?
I should not be wrong anywhere.
Give your best.
Whatever they had thought in the childhood, we will recollect as a guest.
We will try to recollect it in some way, not exactly go back home, but we will try to implement something. So it is from one leader to another leader. So that it is also gratitude. For example,
that is something that we say that there is somebody always looking at you. Keep that in mind.
For example, there is a crisis situation. You saw that your father, when there was a watchman who said that I need some money because my child is going to school and a lot of time for the salary to be received. Can you give me some money? And your father tried to give him. And you asked your father, why did you give? Suppose he does not give back? Then? Because you were a child and you had all that anxiety. And then your father said, it's okay if he doesn't give back also. But I know he will give back. And you see that person coming back with that money and giving. And then you keep seeing your father doing all these things for other people. And there are many lessons you start learning from this transaction. If you have seen a father shouting, doubting, insulting, how dare you come and ask me like this? What kind of value are you taking as a leader in your own office? There is a loss of trust. There is a loss of words. There is a arrogance. There is aggressiveness. I'm just giving one example. That these are values which are nurtured in the house, in the school, in the college. And that's how we carry it in your own offices. It's not in the office only you emerge as a leader. There's an interconnect. If we ask your parents or teachers to rate you as a student and as a leader, there will be a difference or there will be something common that you have to decide. But I hope I'm trying to be very clear as to what I want to say. Am I clear? So I took you on a tour. I took you into the train of the past.
Interconnection is also a
possible part. Perhaps it is. So am I clear with this? Yeah? Then there is also reciprocation as a skill. So to reciprocate, it's a skill. You reciprocate in a positive way. So you're not passive. You're not just receiving. You're reciprocating. So you give back what you receive. From your parents you receive a direction, from your teacher you receive some kind of a focus. You reciprocate it not just to them, but to others also. So in our office we may be a parent of somebody in that sense, because you have skills, you have all the resources, you have the ability to do what you can, so using it in the right way. Like as a parent uses, if there are three children in the house, siblings, what does the parent do? The parent will try to keep all, each child happy. The parent knows each child's skills, the good and the bad. Ye thoda lazy hai. So if the parent wants something from the shop, the parent will send the most active, ja beta, jaldi la. Because dusre ko bolega to abhi nahi, baad mein. The parent has a way to improve him also, not that he will be kept lazy for at work. Even in an organization, the leader knows that who is capable of taking fast orders or delivery. Who is a thinker in the office? Who is a doer in the office? Who is a troublemaker in the office? Like a parent, the leader senses it. And if you have not sensed it, you have to learn that. You cannot always go by the CVs of the people. Those will remain in the files. You have to see what they perform, what are they doing, how are they, and that becomes, it's an art to know people. It's a very delicate process. Huh? You may get into a wrong judgment of a person also. Sometimes the leader may overestimate or underestimate. No, wo aisa nahi hai, wo aisa hi hai. There's a crisis.
Usually there are this talent management, identifying high potential, low potential, there are formal processes out there.
Yes, I'm going beyond the formal. Mm-hmm. I personally feel the leader should have that, cultivate that. Gradually the person should, the formal process, yes. But those are again, these formats will have limitations. It's your, it makes the person more conscious also, in that sense. And then you are putting people into certain compartments. So there can be something which is beyond those compartments. So, when you talk about reciprocation, this is the second. I'll just complete this and get back because I have to complete. Then there is the third skill of being compassionate. So, when you have compassion for the other, see our parents, teachers, or when we look at the compassion of God, there is total compassion. There is something which is there. Now this compassion is also a skill. Everybody is not equally compassionate, or we can't take a crash course in compassion. But a child can be trained to develop compassion. A leader can be developed to be compassionate. It can be suggested. Your family also sometimes trains you to be compassionate. You are put into situations where you are supposed to be compassionate. So life events also, sometimes when you go out of your way to help somebody, you are trying to be compassionate. So that compassion again has a connect to love, concern, that other is not the other, but the other is me. So this, I think, is a skill which is very important for the leader. If you are a compassionate leader, what happens? Can anybody tell me?
Respect and love from your people.
If you give love, you will receive love.
Most
if you give hate, we give, we get it back.
Sensitivity.
Very good word, sensitivity. Yes.
The trust will increase.
Trust will increase. Have you experimented this?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Because I just wanted to validate that these are not theoretical terms. These are what you are doing in the office. Maybe today I have put it, but this is a skill. And I want to ask you, is everybody doing this?
No.
So how are people? People are not compassionate. Some of them are very manipulative, some are very calculative, some say you.
Some is talking with your wings.
Some say why are you doing it? If you do it, you will get trapped, I am telling you.
They are fired up right
now. See, this is where you have to do what you think is right. So if somebody was compassionate and we were the beneficiary, why not we become compassionate as leaders and make others the beneficiary? Isn't it? And if you see this compassion in the industries, the offices, we will see all happy people. And if there is trust, love, as Vivekananda says, wherever there is love, there will be happiness. And whenever there is a tussle between head and the heart, listen to the heart. Moving to the next and the last Purusharthas. When we look at the Purusharthas, Dharma Artha Kama Moksha, Dharma is the dimension of righteousness. We talk about conscience, we talk about commitment, we talk about value base, we talk about harmony. So when we talk about Purusharthas, we are trying to reflect upon skills such as being truthful, so righteous. Trying to follow the path of being righteous, but being truthful. Second is skill of patience. Skill of patience. So what happens when I am value based, I am talking about truth, I am focusing on truth, then I am not trying to be impulsive, I don't want success immediately. I am ready to walk on that right path, and that means I will also have patience. I don't get into the wrong. I don't get into corruption, I don't believe in shortcuts. That's where Purusharthas gives you a map of a good, honest life. So if you are patient, that means you are also trying to be truthful. And third is, I've written two in that, generosity and equanimity. Generosity and equanimity. What is generosity? You are generous to the other. So your kindness in that. Your understanding, you are all encompassing, you are trying to take others also with you further. When you have a Dharma dimension, when you are righteous, and here we try to look at Purusharthas when the focus is on moksha. Here when you talk about leadership, when you want to move towards a higher goal, you have to take everybody with you with the value base. You have to help them to understand what is best. You have to help them to be honest. You have to acknowledge and appreciate. With all this, the journey will become different. Equanimity, balance. What does this balance say? That you should not be too happy, not too sad. Balance, focus. No, equanimity. When we talk about Sthitta Prajna, a leader should be equanimous. Equanimity should be practiced.
Same all.
Yes. So here, from the Purusharthas dimension, when there is a Dharma dimension to it, the Dharma actually helps in being the equanimity dimension is possible because of Dharma. So that's why the Dharma dimension says that don't run after money, don't cheat, don't take momentary pleasures, be focused, follow the path. So always the Dharma is some kind of a conscience factor which tells you to focus, which tells you to have a balance, tells you to have a harmony. And this balance and harmony is something to do with Rina, it has to do with Ritta. So Ritta, Rina, Purusharthas are also interconnected in many ways, and a leader has full scope to experiment this, explore this in all the possible ways, every life situation, every day, every minute, you are practicing this in some way. So I think I have given you in totality all these things which I thought were necessary, and I can take 5 minutes are there for question answer. If you have any questions, you first frame those questions, ask these questions to your own self, and then if you don't get an answer, then ask me. First write the question, frame a question, and then, because asking a question also is an art, no? Ma'am, I just need clarity, something.
doing that, we, yes, some question may have that.
Where would
one minute. Can, has everybody, are you ready with the questions? I'll give you 2 minutes for the questions. First, let them frame, then I think. And I would urge you to ask me questions. If you have any questions. Yes, now you can ask your question.
Where would empathy fit in?
Where would empathy fit in?
Do you think it's not a skill coming out of internet or is it a skill?
As I've said, these are not watertight compartments. As I've said, I thought that these are 3 important skills. You can think about some more skills and you may have a reason to fit in any of those dimensions, but you have to have that connect. That when we talk about empathy, and there may be some skills which may overlap also, you know. So perhaps a skills program can emerge out of these skills. Perhaps when we have leadership programs in the corporate sector or in government offices, there can be a skill program for development of this with base of Rita Rina Purushartha, focus of Indian philosophy and culture. I mean to say, why should we not have training programs with the Indian models? It's high time that we should have exclusively models which have the Indian realm to it. And people in India will get more connected to it. Isn't it?
Yes.
So, why not? Yes. Second question.
First, I thank you personally because okay. That was my question. Okay. I want that proper practical approach from these people. And I got the answer.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
And the question is, if the situation occurs that we may have to ban any old employee due to value-based problems, then what shall we do thinking about humanity?
First thing is, if somebody has made a mistake, not looking at the person as a wrongdoer, but looking at the action as a wrong thing, and there is a tendency which can be corrected. The person may be an asset to the office, may have done a mistake, and it can be corrected over through
but
counseling.
The problem is value-based.
Definitely, it will have a value base, no? When the person is not
repeatedly
in that.
Repeatedly it is happening then.
It repeatedly also, if it is happening, then there is also a problem with the leader who is not able to understand the problem. If the problem is repeated, the leader has not thought out of the box to resolve that problem. There cannot be any problem which cannot be solved. The only thing, we don't want to solve it in the way we want it. Are you understanding? So, you can give this problem to another leader and the leader will solve it in 5 minutes. So, it depends on the perspective of the leader, how he is looking at the problem. First, whether for that leader the problem is a problem. For example, there is a perennial problem in many offices that some people do not work. It's a perennial problem. And there are few only who work. That is also something as a fact. How do you say? Every leader will say, I will focus on those who work, I will not look at those who don't work. I don't want to waste my energy. Second will say, I will make something inspiring for those and help them to work. So each leader may have a different perspective. It depends on your understanding and your dynamics with the human person and how do you resolve it. So I do not think that the person should be removed, punished in that sense. If we are adults, there may be something in that person which needs correction and there is a reason why the person behaves the way the person behaves. People are not fond of being wrong or bad. There is a story behind that also. There are sad stories behind that. They did not get the direction. Nobody guided them. Nobody told that this was wrong what you're doing. That's what I said. Everybody is not so fortunate. So why do you expect everybody to be good, good, good? We will not find such. We are trying to have a perfect picture in our organization which may not be there. There may be some alcoholics in your office who may be coming. There may be some who don't feel like working when they are at workplace.
there may be people who are extremely bored, there are people extremely distracted. The leader has to find a way how to keep them. That is an art. And that's a difficult art, let me tell you. It's not an easy thing. But if you really respect human person, then you will take that effort. To remove somebody is very easy, no? How much time it takes to give a memo? It's easy. But going beyond. Next question. Oh, many questions.
My understanding of the theory of karma and astrology was that when a rebirth happens, the impression of the previous birth are the one which I can getting carried, and that is what my bhagya is, and that's how my astrological charting happens, because the previous birth impressions fall back into the next birth. Now, what I learned is, how can I change that bhagya of mine is by purushartha. So what I understood was that purushartha is more of an action or a continuous hard work or efforts in a particular direction to correct those wrong impressions or whatever has happened in my, previous birth or whatever the bhagya is designed for me. That's how purushartha comes into picture. So my love can be something, but then if I make an effort, I can change that as well, is what But whereas when we said, when we discussed Tushar here, we said being thankful or skill of patience. Now, how that Purushartha, which I understood was more of hard work and effort and this thing come to Purushartha, and how this is the two, I'm not able to connect this to here, that's really.
When I'm talking about Purushartha, when I'm talking about patience, I'm trying to say when we try to be righteous, we are also inculcating that patience. Because when you are trying to be righteous, there is a waiting, no? Everything will not happen the way you want fast. When you are on the path of righteousness, it will come. But you will have to wait for that, you will have to work for it. So there is patience in that waiting. And when you are on the right path of virtue, you will have tough problems. But you are certain to reach where you want to reach. So in that sense, whatever the karmic thing with which we are born, that is one. But it is said that even God says that I will not interfere in this. Because you have got your intellect, you have your buddhi, man, etc. You have to take care and you have to find out further things. But here, as we are trying to say, I am guided by the righteous. And I am, when righteousness is my focus, then even when I am earning well, I am deriving some pleasure, whatever I am trying to do is with the dimension of that righteousness. Yes.
My question is...
Two more questions, then we stop.
My question is from the viewpoint of self-awareness. Then let's say I am aware that there are quite a lot of elements that are causing a disorder in this order. Like for example, there are corrupt people. Or there are external factors that do not allow you to be righteous. Because I maybe have to face some bad consequences of it. So is that right? Would you call it righteous to just withdraw and acknowledge that yes, I'm wrong, right is wrong. But I'm not going and becoming a krantikari. Is that the right thing to do?
It depends on the level of self-awareness where you have reached. There are certain patterns of self-awareness where we try to say that there is something wrong which is going on. With a higher pattern that I must do something about it. With a still higher that I should do it in such a way that it is done in such a way that I get the best benefit of it. So a person who is emotionally matured and spiritually directed will be in a position to imagine the crisis and still take up the challenge and move. Because we have examples of people, as I told you that one person asked me that if I am amidst all corrupt people, what should I do? And I said that you become a lotus. That's not just a poetic thing which I said, but we have examples of people who were amidst many corrupt people, but they emerge as very bold people. So there is a possibility that your self-awareness, how much that level you have reached, but it is not an idealistic thing. people do have conflicts, but when there is a conflict between the bad and the good will emerge if you have that courage to take it till the end. Definitely. Yes.
Ma'am, this is about the loyalties of employees towards the employers. So there is a tendency of employees to be sympathetic toward their colleagues in spite of best treatment by employers. The loyalty remains with their colleagues rather than their leader employer. So how does the leader overcome this tendency?
The leader will not be always in a position to keep the employee happy, because finally there is a gap between the leader and the employee, and how much our good is, there is some kind of a thing, some kind of a talking which is happening because that is human tendency. So about loyalties, I would look at it psychologically, that psychologically there are group formations where people identify with each other and they like to share the problems with each other. So the leader may not always feel closer to that person, or the person may not necessarily come and tell everything to the leader. So such kind of zones, these are unseen zones, but these zones do exist. There are only few leaders who are very, very successful in breaking these zones. But again, there are certain things where people say that there is a lot of politics in this process. There are very, very few leaders who are very genuine leaders, who have noble intention of breaking these barriers and making people focus. Because generally a leader has a lot of ego and he does not want to familiarize with people too much, because then he loses his focus. So there are people, leaders, who don't want people to come closer, and he doesn't mind if they are closer to their own group. So in that psychological sense, a good leader should try to be so good that the employer feels it's very comfortable to come and speak, and there are no such groups.
Because
most of the time negative talk starts here only, you know, gossip starts. So, I take the last question. If there is any last question from someone else, we want more people to ask questions. And then we take a 2 minutes feedback of the lecture. Yes, and one last question from someone who has not asked a question. But you have to repeat the question. If you want, if it has a connect to what we are doing, otherwise we can leave it. I'll answer it, but not now. Yes, any question? Anybody? Sure? Then we have to take one question, last question.
In Purushartha, we took three skills, that three skills are connected to dharma and related to artha, kama and moksha. What should skills be there?
These will manifest, no? If you are truthful, you will be truthful in your earning, you will be truthful in your joy moments also. It will lead to elevation, isn't it? Okay, now I want a few of you to... This was a different lecture in that sense. It was not from any book. It was not from a particular model which has been designed. This has been a lecture which I designed for you because I felt it was required. So I want feedback on how did you take this, what was your impact? At least one or two people can share.
No, in fact, I feel that the way we have a sub-planning model, you know, Rita, Rina and Tushar can further develop into more
just
pillars.
So that,
as if we have a sub-planning model, you know, Rita, Rina and Tushar can further be developed into a proper model, because this is the structure which we have, and it is a very deep subject.
Yes.
I think what is missing here is putting more words and putting more, legislature, structure and legislature. I think that this can actually become a structure in itself.
Then
even I feel the same.
and it can be further developed into identifying the skills and coming out of the skill training program or skill development program.
That's what I said, skill development program can evolve. I am also eager to know the lecture. How did you receive it? Because it was a very different lecture in that sense. What was your first take with this kind of...
The skills which you have enumerated, possibly we can get more and identify more skills.
Yes, that is your homework. That's what I said. I am going to say only 3, but you can have 30. That's it. No, means you can give 300 also.
Yes. Like, I just want to teach within the same what you said, like as a homework, but some practical, because I think the way I could, what I could sense is that there is, I think, many examples where these become related in our own lives.
Yes.
And so if we can think together, okay, how practically this can is applied in our lives, then I think the whole thing what we are talking about, structure would become more.
And you forgot the last time's homework which I gave you. I had asked you to bring at least 3 case studies where Riddha, Rina and Purusharth are in practice.
Practice.
So this is a homework for you. Think about it. Riddha, Rina and Purusharth, these are in practice in some companies, in direct or indirect ways.
Real case studies.
Are there any such real case studies? And if they are, what are they? So it was lovely talking to all of you, and the references and all I will share as it is required. My paper is with you for reference, co-authored paper with Dr. Joshi. The books and all that which is required. So I had a wonderful time reflecting, developing this session, and it was indeed a different experience. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.